Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am going to talk about the module Urbanization and Dimensions of Well-being from Population, Urbanization and Poverty. So students, we are going to discuss about various concepts and aspects of well-being. We will also discuss how urbanization increases or diminishes the level of happiness and well-being of urban citizens. So in this perspective, this model aims to throw light on the concept of well-being, the aspects of well-being, main indicators of gross national happiness, the social progress index, basic human needs, foundations of well-being, urbanization and opportunity, happy planet index and well-being, experienced well-being in urban areas, thriving, struggling and suffering population. Urbanization is a process closely linked to economic development, but its effects on well-being have changed over time and can vary across urban environments. Urbanization represents both opportunity and risk, and a fresh set of challenges for those concerned with protecting and promoting well-being of urban residents. Actually, the very concept of well-being seems to be a subjective phenomena, which cannot be measured like other indicators of development. However, it is being felt that the income alone is not a true indicator of better quality of life. All rational human efforts are for a better and happy life. Many a times, the measures or the decisions to avail an opportunity which gives rise to income or social status may not bring happiness. But the big challenge is how to measure it and so that the impact of growth upon it can be judged. In recent years, well-being has moved from the realm of philosophy to that of science. There has been a growing body of research into what contributes to the quality of people's experiences of their lives. This has enabled a new understanding of the factors that both influence and constitute well-being. It may include a sense of individual vitality, competence, and autonomy to engage themselves in meaningful activities and enable them to cope against the odds of life and be resilient to changes beyond their immediate control. Thus, well-being means that people should feel that their lives are going well. Well-being is most usually thought of as the dynamic process that gives people a sense of how their lives are going through the interaction between their circumstances, activities, and psychological resources or mental capital. Because of this dynamic nature, high levels of well-being mean that we are more able to respond to difficult circumstances, to innovate and constructively engage with other people and the world around us, as well as representing a highly effective way of bringing about good outcomes in many different areas of our lives. There is also a strong case for regarding well-being as an ultimate goal of human endeavor. Now let us define well-being. Perhaps the most cumbersome yet important task before the social science researchers is to define well-being. The big question is whether it can really be defined or measured in a precise manner. In economic literature, we can find a number of ways in which the concept of well-being is defined. Many of the studies have argued that the well-being is actually a subjective phenomena, and therefore its dimensions may vary according to the changing dynamics of life. World Health Organization has defined well-being in terms of quality of life. It defined quality of life as an individual's perception of their position in life in context of the culture and value systems in which they live and in relation to their goals, expectations, standards, and concerns. It is a broad-ranging concept affected in a complex way by the person's physical, health, psychological state, personal beliefs, social relationships, and their relationship to salient features of their environment. The concept of well-being is undeniably complex. It is also being stated as the balancing point between challenges and resources. Brickman and Campbell, as well as Henry and Klopp, have defined the well-being in the manner as shown in figure 1. We can see from the seesaw figure which defines well-being and show that each time an individual meets a challenge, the system of challenge and resources comes into a state of imbalance. As the individual is forced to adapt his or her resources to meet this particular challenge, in essence, stable well-being is when individuals have the psychological, social, and physical resources they need to meet a particular psychological, social, and/or physical challenge. When individuals have more challenges than resources, the seesaw dips along with their well-being and vice versa. This definition helps to understand how people cope with change and how their levels of well-being are affected. Let us discuss about various aspects of well-being. Looking at the definition of the well-being, another important question is about the components of well-being. That is, what type of resources are required to maintain the balance with the challenges? There are a number of ways through which the well-being can be measured. Though income indicator is always considered to be a proxy for the experienced prosperity, but it has always ignored the negative well-being implications of the longer working hours and other stresses. The GDP indicators are criticized for failing to take into account of inequality, environmental costs, expenditure due to negative events, and the value of unpaid work, and for ignoring direct measures of other aspects of welfare, such as health and education. Economic indicators have been used as proxies for well-being under the assumptions of classical economics, that people have rational and stable preferences and that their well-being is greatest when they have maximum opportunities to satisfy their wants and desires. Typically, it has been assumed that maximizing opportunity is a matter of maximizing individual wealth. So, if people are wealthier, the theory says they will be happier. But psychologists have tested these classical assumptions against observations of real economic behavior and have found that people often make decisions and choices that are irrational, at least in the terms set out by economists. Economists themselves have also started to test the relationship between well-being and income using subjective measures of well-being. Typically, these are responses to large-scale surveys where people provide a self-reported assessment of their happiness and satisfaction with life, which research suggests provides reliable ratings of overall life satisfaction. If classical economics is right, we would expect people to report greater satisfaction with their lives as they become wealthier. However, this may not always be true, as GDP may not provide an adequate and full assessment of the state of a society because it does not account for the conditions and well-being of individuals, families, and the communities. Moreover, GDP does not include economic activities outside the market, such as caring for people in the households, even though without caregiving, there would be no workforce. In his seminal work, Development as Freedom, Amartya Sen contrasts the remarkable economic progress and wealth created in the last century to the devastating deprivation, destitution, and oppression suffered by billions of people worldwide, especially women and children. He argues for an integrative framework in economics that moves the focus from market expansion to the improvement of individual lives, which will invariably lead to sustainable economic growth. Further, Stiglitz, Sen, and Fitoussi have also stated that under rising inequalities, GDP or any other aggregate computed per capita may not provide an accurate assessment of the well-being of the citizens. Thus, on basis of these arguments and review of the related literature on limitations of GDP as an exact indicator of well-being, the World Happiness Report and the Social Progress Indicators have evolved a set of indicators to measure the well-being of the citizens. Before explaining these indicators, let us have a look at the composition of Gross National Happiness Index developed by World Happiness Report. According to this report, the Gross Happiness Index has 9 domains and 33 indicators of national happiness. Here, happiness is considered to be a variable of well-being. These include education, health, living standards, psychological well-being, ecological diversity and resilience, community vitality, good governance, cultural diversity and resilience and time use. Each of this domain is further divided into a set of indicators. The total number of these indicators is 33. Similarly, the Social Progress Index discusses about 3 main indicators, which are further divided into 54 sub-indicators. Besides, we can also rely upon Gallup World Poll and Happy Planet Index for analyzing various aspects of well-being. Although all such reports give extensive data at the region as well as the country level, but none of these have shown any rural-urban breakup. Since our interest is to look at the association between urbanization and well-being, we would try to associate various indicators with the level of urbanization in each economy. The Social Progress Index is a simple average of the indices related with basic human needs, foundation of well-being, and opportunity. Before we elaborate each of the indicators of well-being, here, the relationship of overall social progress and urbanization can be observed from figure 2. The figure indicates a positive association between the social progress index of a country, which is taken here as an indicator of overall well-being of an average citizen, and the level of urbanization in each economy. Now we can discuss each of the component of well-being and its association with urbanization. First of these components is basic human needs. Basic human needs cover the basic necessity of a person that must be fulfilled for his survival and healthy life. This indicator is an average of 4 broad indicators, which include nutrition, and basic medical care, water and sanitation facilities, shelter and personal safety. The indices of nutrition and basic medical care further includes the percentage of population whose nutritional intake is insufficient and how much calories are needed to lift him or her from the status of being undernourished, maternal mortality rate, stillbirth rate, child mortality rate, deaths from infectious diseases, access to piped water, access to improved sanitation facilities, access to affordable housing and quality of available shelter, and personal safety against violence, crime, and political terror. An overview of attainment of the basic human needs can be observed from Figure 4. The figure shows that for high-income countries, the index value for basic human needs is also high, while India, Bangladesh, Nepal, and Pakistan have been among the low achievers. Actually, each of the sub-index of basic human needs, that is nutrition and basic medical care, water and sanitation, shelter and personal safety, all are positively related with per capita income and the urbanization rates. Therefore, it is but natural that the overall index of basic human needs is high for more developed, industrialized and urbanized countries as compared to the developing economies in which these rates are relatively lower. The second indicator is related with foundations of well-being. The indicator of foundations of well-being includes the equitable access to basic knowledge, information and communications, health and wellness, and sustainability of the ecosystem. These indices are further decomposed into 16 more sub-indices covering adult literacy rate, literacy at the primary and secondary level, gender parity in access to education, number of mobile, telephone, and internet users, freedom of press, life expectancy, probability of deaths from non-communicable diseases, obesity rate, suicide rates, deaths due to outdoor air pollution, greenhouse gas emissions, water withdrawals, and protection of biodiversity and natural habitat. In figure, we can see that in most of the highly urbanized economies, the index value of foundations of well-being is also higher, and they seem to be going hand in hand. However, in the South Asian economies, especially in Nepal and Sri Lanka, the level of urbanization is not affecting the level of foundations of well-being, and relatively higher values of foundations of well-being are achieved even with lower rate of urbanization. Actually, in these economies, the governments have taken due care of education and health facilities irrespective of the rural and urban locations. Sri Lanka has higher rank among all the South Asian economies on human capital indicators as well as social protection index. Still, we can see a positive association of urbanization rates and the index value of the foundation of well-being in Figure 7. The positive slope of the curve itself indicates that as the level of urbanization increases, the value of the sub-indices of the indicator of foundation of well-being also increases. The third indicator is that of opportunity. Another indicator of well-being of a person is the degree and quality of opportunity. This index includes the personal rights, personal freedom and choice, tolerance and inclusion, and equitable access to advanced education of international standards. The correlation of opportunity and urbanization is again found to be positive, showing that all the dimensions of opportunities have a higher value in more urbanized societies. Happy Planet Index and well-being. Another attempt to measure the well-being of the individuals is the Happy Planet Index, developed by New Economic Foundation, London. This is based upon three indicators. These are well-being, life expectancy, and ecological footprints. Each of three components is given a traffic light score based on the thresholds for good, that is green, middling, that is amber, and bad, that is red performance. These scores are combined to an expanded six-color traffic lights for the overall HPI score, where to achieve bright green, the best of the six colors, a country would have to perform well on all the three individual components for greater happiness of its citizens. The index uses global data on life expectancy. The index uses global data on life expectancy, experienced well-being, and ecological footprint, and is calculated by using this formula. The formula clearly shows that a higher value of experienced well-being and life expectancy gives a higher value of happiness index, while a higher value of ecological prints lowers it. Hence, the Happy Planet Index is equal to experienced well-being multiplied by life expectancy divided by ecological footprints. Each of these components is based on a separate measure. First component is that of experienced well-being. For knowing how well someone's life is going on, it is better to ask them directly. Therefore, HPI calculates experienced well-being by using a question called the Ladder of Life from the Gallup Word Pool. This asks respondents to imagine a ladder termed as Cantrell ladder of 0 to 10 steps, where 0 represents the worst possible life and the 10 the best possible life. People are asked to report the step of ladder they feel they currently stand on. It also asks them the future step on the ladder they expect to stand on. The next component is that of life expectancy. Alongside experienced well-being, the HPI includes a universally important measure of health, that is life expectancy. For this purpose, the life expectancy data from UNDP Human Development Report is used. The basic idea behind calculating the Happy Planet Index is that most measures of national progress are actually just measures of economic activity, that is, how much we are producing or consuming. By only using indicators like GDP to measure success, we are not accounting for what really matters: producing happy lives, people, now and in the future. The Happy Planet Index puts current and future well-being at the heart of measurement. It frames the development of each country in the context of real environmental limits. In doing so, it tells us what we instinctively know to be true, that progress is not just about wealth. It shows that while the challenges faced by rich, resource-intensive nations and those with high level of poverty and deprivation may be very different, the end goal is same. That is, to produce happy, healthy lives now and in the future. The Happy Planet Index demonstrates that the dominant Western model of development is not sustainable, and we need to find other development paths towards sustainable well-being. In this respect, on a scale of 0 to 100, for the Happy Planet Index, there is a target for the nations to aspire by 2050 of 89. This is based on attainable levels of life expectancy and well-being and a reasonably sized ecological footprint. The current results confirm that we are not living on a happy planet. No country is able to combine success across the three goals of high life expectancy, high experienced well-being, and living within environmental limits. Whilst many high-income countries score low because of their large ecological footprints, the lowest income countries, for example, in sub-Saharan Africa, tend to mark, while many high-income countries score low because of their large ecological footprints, the lowest income countries in sub-Saharan Africa tend to rank even lower because of low life expectancy and low well-being. High and medium development Latin American countries score highest in delivering fairly long and happy lives with a relatively low ecological footprint. We can see the scores of top 7 and bottom 3 countries on the scores of happiness in table 1 and its correlation with urbanization. In the table, as already mentioned, the red shows bad, green good, and amber middling performance. The deep red shows alarmingly bad and deep green the best performance. Similarly, we have light and dark amber showing low and high middling performance. Further, here an attempt has been made to correlate these performances with the urbanization rates. In table 1, we can see that none of the well-known developed and high-income economies have appeared in the top 7 happiest economies. The world average at 42.5 is much lower than the targeted value of 89. Even the happiest economies are far away from their targeted level. In case of overall index, we cannot see a clear relationship with urbanization, as Vietnam with a very low level of urbanization at about 32% is the second place of happiness index, while Qatar with about 99% rate of urbanization is having the third lowest rank. It seems that as the urbanization increases, happiness falls. But if we look at the right side of this table, which shows the index value of experienced well-being and urbanization, it seems that as urbanization increases, the experienced well-being increases, especially among the top 7 rankers. Therefore, it is important to look at other two components as well. We can see that as urbanization increases, the value of each score increases. The countries with higher rates of urbanization also have higher scores of life expectancy and ecological footprints. Since the value of the ecological footprints has a negative impact upon the overall happiness impact, an increase in its value along with urbanization rates definitely reduces the overall HPI. This explains why highly developed and urbanized economies are not the happiest one. From various components of HPI, we can easily see that the world would not be able to achieve the ideal level of happiness or the well-being until the ecological footprints are not reduced. And this is especially challenging in a rapidly urbanizing world. Without reducing the ecological footprints, no growth would be sustainable and well-being would be hard to achieve. Now let us see how urbanization influences the experienced well-being. This can be further classified into thriving, struggling, or suffering. Another measure of well-being, which is also used by Happy Planet Index, is the Gallup Index on the Cantrell Ladder Scale. Gallup asks ordinary individuals for their thoughts and opinions on several topics, including economics, religion, migration, and well-being. Gallup's data provide sound evidence on many issues that more than 98% of the world's adult population faces. The life is evaluated as thriving, struggling, and suffering in countries and regions across the world. Gallup's Thriving, Struggling, and Suffering indexes measure respondents' perceptions of where they stand now and in future. Based on Cantrell's Self-Anchoring Striving Scale, Gallup measures life satisfaction by asking respondents to rate their present and future lives on a ladder scale with steps numbered from 0 to 10, where 0 indicates the worst possible life and 10 the best possible life. Individuals who rate their current lives a 7 or higher and their future an 8 or higher are considered thriving. Individuals are suffering if they report their current and future lives as 4 or lower. All other individuals are considered struggling. The experienced well-being also includes daily well-being averages, that is 0 to 10, based on responses to 10 items measuring daily experiences, that is feeling well, rested, being treated with respect, smiling, laughter, learning, interest, enjoyment, physical pain, worry, sadness, stress, and anger. Each daily experience is scored dichotomously with higher scores representing better days, more positive and less negative daily experiences or effects. Since in Happy Planet Index, we have observed a positive association between the experienced well-being and the urbanization rates, it is important here to look at the proportion of thriving, struggling, and suffering populations in the top as well as the bottom scores. For this, we can see table 2. A quick look at the table clearly shows that as urbanization increases, the proportion of the population who see their lives as thriving increases, while that of struggling and suffering falls. In Denmark, where the proportion of urban population is about 87%, the life is thriving for 82% of people, who further evaluate their daily experience at 7.9 between a scale of 0 to 10. On the other hand, in Togo and Burundi, the proportion of urban population is about 39 and 11% respectively. And merely 1 and 2% of people consider their life as thriving, and 31 and 40% people are suffering in these countries respectively. Thus, on the scale of well-being, the urbanization seems to have a positive effect. But on daily experience, the level of urbanization does not seem to have a very strong effect, as in Israel, where about 92% of population lives in urban areas, the daily experience is scaled at 6.4 as compared to 7.5 in Burundi, where merely 11% population live in urban areas. Therefore, the daily experience is weakly related with urbanization. So students, let us summarize what we have learned from this module. To sum up, we can say that the income indicators may not be clearly showing the real picture if we are really concerned with quality of life. The quality of life, or say the well-being, is influenced by number of non-income factors. The very concept of well-being is quite dynamic in its composition and includes a number of dimensions. Though it is hard to rely upon a single index for evaluating the well-being of a society in urban areas, where different dimensions may also be overlapping each other, yet we have tried to correlate each of the dimensions with level of urbanization in different economies. And it has been observed that urbanization has a positive impact upon the well-being of the masses, indicating that the economies, as they urbanize themselves, the well-being of the citizens improves. However, the environmental sustainability is the greatest obstacle in achievement of well-being of the people in urban areas. The well-being of the urban people and an urbanizing society would improve significantly if the societies are able to reduce their ecological footprints. That's all with today's lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed it. Thank you.